Good evening. I'd like to thank the members of the City Council, Planning Board, Economic Development Commission, and the public for attending tonight's meeting. Tonight we'll hear the second and final presentation regarding the just completed parking supply and demand analysis. As you know, at the City Council's request, they desired that we conduct this objective analysis of the downtown parking to provide us with current verified data to use in determining how to proceed to address our parking needs. In particular, I believe it was the Council's intent to develop this type of detailed objective data prior to making any decisions regarding construction of a new parking garage. After tonight, city staff will take some of the key data developed through the parking study and put together a series of options for consideration by the City Council, Planning Board, and the EDC as we move through and to address our parking needs. Nelson Nygaard Consulting Associates, the firm that carried out this work for the city, specializes in parking demand management, public transit, and multi-model transportation planning with a focus on planning transportation systems that support vibrant, sustainable communities. Jason Schreiber of Nelson Nygaard, he is a principal and the team leader for the Portsmouth project, will be making this evening's presentation. Jason has 15 years of experience in parking management, including leading planning efforts for the municipal parking system in Cambridge, Massachusetts, and managing parking regulations for the city's 2,000 private off-street spaces. With that, I'll turn the program over to Jason.
Thank you, Mr. Is this working? Does everybody hear me there? Thank you, Mr. Manager. My name is again Jason Schreiber with Nelson Nygaard. I'm going to run you through a quick summary, as quick as I possibly can, of the findings of the work that we conducted. The work that we did was this fall, and we collected as much information as we could in a study area around the downtown. The slides here, let's see if this is working. There it goes. We'll walk you through all of that information as succinctly as I can. My apologies in advance, as there actually is a lot of information there. I'll try to go through it as fun as we possibly can about the exciting topic of parking. And I'd like to take a break and take some questions, certainly from the council and others. And then there's a second half of the presentation, talk a little bit about some of the best practices in the parking industry. We're not charged with making any recommendations or findings as part of our work. We really were just collecting information that city staff will be able to use in their decision-making processes in the coming months and years. But we do this work all around the country, and so there'll be a time to talk a little bit about some of the best practices we've found and how they may be applicable. This is our overall study area, which surrounds the downtown core of Portsmouth, and all these maps north will be to the top of the screen. And the boundary we chose was intended to be able to capture the downtown commercial core, as well as going out into the residential neighborhoods abutting it to a certain degree to be able to assess whether or not there were parking impacts, what the relationship was between the surrounding neighborhoods and the commercial core. In that entire study area, there's about 5,600 parking spaces. I won't go through all the points of what they are specifically, but they're broken out in our database according to time limits and who's in control and what type of parking it is signed for. This is a map. What we do is we code each and every one of those parking facilities, both off-street and on-street, according to one of these categories, and then with the actual number of spaces that are observed. And then we start to try to collect data on these parking spaces throughout the course of an average weekday and an average weekend. This is the high-level summary of all of the data that was collected, broken out in terms of on-street and off-street parking, for an average Thursday of data collection that was done this past fall. We use Thursdays because it happens to be a very good typical representation of downtowns and studies we do all around the country. And essentially what it's saying to us is that today, within a 10-minute walking radius or so of Market Square, which is what that study area approximately encompasses, you have a good number of parking spaces that are available at the peak of the peak in the middle of the day, a couple hundred on street, probably over 1,000 off-street. Now, this includes public and private parking spaces. This is the aggregate supply. This includes neighborhood streets. On a Saturday, the parking situation gets a little bit more constrained in Portsmouth. Again, we collected this in the fall. And you'll see that there are some spaces available at certain points of the day, but as we get to the evening hours, and this is from 10 a.m. through to 8 p.m. on this graphic, those are the, if I didn't describe it, the utilized spaces, and the white is the vacant spaces, it gets harder and harder to find parking. This red line that we have drawn here is considered the ideal utilization rate, above which it's just so hard to find a parking space, it's effectively at capacity. And you'll see that on-street parking in Portsmouth breaks that barrier on a Saturday evening. Off-street parking in the study area is not as congested. But again, we're looking at a large 10-minute radius. If we start to bring that radius down a little bit, we looked at a couple of sub-areas. This one matches the downtown overlay district, or more or less the commercial heart of Portsmouth. And in that radius, there's only about 3,500 parking spaces, so we're not including the surrounding residential neighborhoods and surrounding development related to them. And in that district, the downtown overlay, which we're calling about a 5-minute walk or so from Market Square, here's that demand profile, builds up towards noon, lessens out, gets a little bit busier again in the evening. But overall, the parking spaces, again, this is everything, public, private, on-street, off-street, is only about 60% utilized, so about 1,400 parking spaces. And then the remainder of that area, of the study area, there's still about another 900 spaces open at peak. When you look at Saturday and this aggregate supply, once again, you'll see that the downtown core, again, is getting very busy. And this is including all on and off-street spaces. I already showed you that the on-street spaces are already beyond capacity. Well, every single available off-street space is also starting to approach that line, exceeding 70% or three-quarters full. The surrounding area, which doesn't have quite as many parking spaces in it, is not quite as burdened. But, of course, everybody wants to be as close to the core, particularly in the evenings. Now, the problem is those numbers are suggesting that, oh, there's spare parking. But if you look around at the streets of Portsmouth, anybody going to Market Square would automatically recognize that there's much of a parking crunch going on in Portsmouth. And when you look at certain subsets of that parking pool, for instance, paid parking, the commercial parking that's available to the public where you pay a meter or a pay station or in a garage, it's getting a lot tighter. You'll see that you break capacity on a Saturday within that 5-minute walk, and even the outer, it's supposed to be an S, spaces in that area are also approaching capacity that are for the public, the people who come in and find it difficult to find parking sometimes. This is the entryway of the High Hanover Garage. Now, that garage itself also gets very good utilization, approaching 80% on a typical work day. This is a Thursday. Now, it's not 100% full, but sometimes you will get there and it is 100% full. On average, you could argue that there's about 100 spare spaces before you hit reserve. Most of them are up on the roof, but they're there. They're not in the most ideal location, but you might find them on an average day. And this is actually data that comes from the automated pay station that's collecting receipts as folks drive in, and it pretty much nearly matches the curve of observations that we actually had for that facility throughout the day. So that is a good representation of what happens on an average day. A year ago in 2010, it was actually a little bit less busy. But this is, again, October. If you were to look at a Saturday, for instance, we started to see that it was a little bit busier. Now, this is, again, October. If we were to look at different months throughout the year, this comes from, again, the automated gate transactions, you'll see that now and then that High and Hanover Garage hits capacity. And in July and August, nearly half, at least a third of the days of a given month, it does hit capacity, usually on a weekend, on a Saturday, I would presume. But it does say that there begin to be capacity issues, and just from this past July, the garage counting mechanisms show that indeed it's a very busy garage on an average day. Now, besides that, you start to look at other places that are outside of the downtown core. We start to look at some of the streets extending away from the downtown, and some of them are very heavily utilized. And what you're starting to see is a picture of how people respond to parking regulations and pricing, which motivates their decision on where to park. Some of these are private lots that get filled up. Some of these are public spaces or public streets that get filled up. I think this is the lot north of the tracks, for instance. And I'm going to show you on a map the spatial utilization of these spaces, all of that inventory mapped out throughout the span of our days of data collection. And for all of these graphics, you'll see in the lower left here the chart essentially that says where it's white, it's so poorly utilized, in other words, under 60%, that we effectively think it's more or less wide open. When it gets to be blue, you're in a between 60 and 80% range of utilization, which says folks are using this lookout. Green is considered the ideal industry standard rate of utilization, between 80 and 90%. You're at your sweet spot. Beyond that, we throw in this pink color to say, look out, we're getting all the way up to capacity. This is a problem. And if you actually find anything that's in bright red, you've actually blown capacity. You're over the stated capacity, and that's a clear problem. At 8 a.m. in the morning, across the tracks from downtown, you will see already folks have come in on an average workday to park up there. There's a lot of free, unregulated parking. There's actually a stretch of meters right there that is white, and everything else around it is red. People are responding to pricing, and they have the ability to park here all day long and then work in the core. And the core is not quite as busy. Right around Market Square, there's some activity. You already see 85%, some over 90% utilization, right in that core and that heart. But the rest of the downtown is not too busy yet. The Parrott Street lot, folks have come in. Again, it's the same kind of commute function or longer-term parking function that you may find there. And then down here, the Masonic lot is an interesting one that's very busy at 8 a.m. And we've surmised it's probably going to be residents parking there who then clear out, because by 10 a.m. as we advance the clock, you'll see here that it goes away in terms of activity. A lot of folks have cleared out, and there's another lot on the other side of the ponds there that's not too busy yet either. But the downtown core is getting quite busy here. We're at 10 a.m., the core of the downtown is getting very busy. Here we are advancing to noon. The activity has started to expand outside of the Parrott lot. You can see there's some activity for an event over at Strawberry Hill. There's obviously more and more of this red parking spreading to the north and up and down throughout the core of downtown. There's still, I would assume, employees parking on the other side of the tracks. The High Hanover Garage has now just exceeded 60% utilization, so it's starting to get busy. It's not 80 or 90%, but it's starting to get used. Here we are heading into the afternoon, and it starts to relieve somewhat. You lose the activity at the Strawberry Hill. You lose some of the activity as we get towards 4 p.m. on the other side of the tracks, and that starts to compress slightly. By 6 p.m., you're seeing a lot less activity in the remote parking areas. The High Hanover Garage is not as busy as it was at noontime, but the core and the downtown core, you're seeing this expansion of activity all throughout the downtown now. Lots of streets, we're getting into the dining hour, are being filled up with folks coming to shop, coming to dine. And then we even collected data going on until 8 p.m., where you'll see, again, that activity is very strong in the core. High Hanover is still not heavily utilized, but at 8 p.m., now it's the only facility with pricing. And so there's a lot of free on-street parking, and folks are taking advantage of that. You'll see that there's not as much remote activity going on up there or down by the Parrott lot. But the area of influence of busy parking activity has really expanded. So again, your evenings are a time of a lot of parking pressure on-street. They're not necessarily a time of a lot of parking pressure off street, at least right now. On Saturdays at 10 a.m., it's a somewhat similar picture. The downtown activity is pretty spread out around Market Square. You've got a few folks taking advantage of the remote parking on the other side of the tracks. There's apparently an event going on at the hotel at this time that we are counting. Even the Parrot Lot on the weekend is getting some activity. And down here, the Masonic lots and the lots by the library and others are actually probably used by residents. Maybe there's a sporting event going on there. As we get to noontime, you'll see that down there, the activity has actually lessened. The downtown core is getting a lot busier. There's employees that are beginning to, I assume, park for long term, again, on the other side of the tracks. Maybe it's some clever visitors, I'm not sure. More of the free parking that's filled up is filled up by the Parrot Lot, but the area of activity on a Saturday around lunchtime is a lot busier and broader, which makes sense. You're going to have a lot more of tourist activity. And the High and Hanover garage is above 80%, heading towards 90% at that time. You get to 2 p.m., it starts to relieve a slight bit at the garage. You'll see there's actually more people parking along here and filling these areas up to capacity. The library is probably attracting patrons more at that hour. By 4 p.m., that has started to contract again somewhat. In downtown, we're getting a lot more activity. And again, by here we are at 6 p.m., effectively that whole radius of activity has really expanded. And this is when your parking supply, is particularly on street, really begins to be crunched. And you see more and more of these off-street facilities approaching their capacity as well. By 8 p.m., there's a lot of red in the core of Portsmouth. The High Hanover Garage is probably the one good, safe place to go to get a space. But overall, a lot of things, including private off-street lots and the public off-street lots, are very busy. So the profile of on-street parking spaces on a Thursday, as I talked about earlier, is pretty busy. Off-street parking spaces, again, still have a fair amount of capacity to them. But when you get to the Saturday, it's really where you have a lot of crunch, and that's beginning to be a problem in your community. I'll take a quick clarifying question, but I want to save questions till later for brevity. All of this is our October data. Absolutely, all this is our October data. Here we are Saturday off street. Again, there is some relief off street on a Saturday. This is just a quick map for reference to remember where the public and private parking is, but also to understand the relationship of it too. Much of that off street capacity that I talk about is in private lots that the city doesn't have direct influence over. But the green facilities are the public lots and the garage. And it's that paid parking that gets to be a lot more constrained. In particular, as you take a look at the downtown core, especially as you head towards the evening and the surrounding spaces, there's not a lot of extra space that's available in the evenings. You're not being completely slammed, but you start to get to certain points of the day where it's a problem. And here we looked at some of the individual public parking lots and the garage that the city is in control of. And what's interesting is that there's a lot of variability in their utilization. This is a picture quickly at noontime and again at 8 p.m. And it really has a lot to do with where you're located or maybe what's the place that seems to have the perception of more capacity when folks get there. But for instance, in the evening, Masonic Lot and the South Mill Lot across the causeway, there's not a lot of people in those, but in here we've got the Worth Lot and the Bridge Street Lot. A lot of the core lots get very busy. We looked at the Worth Lot, for instance, and it is a very attractive lot. It gets increasing activity throughout the day. There's a lot of points of turnover that happen in the Worth Lot. It's clearly a destination, so when you go and count it, there may be a vacancy shown in it, but it's definitely the kind of facility that gets a lot of activity. Whereas the Masonic Lot, as I showed you earlier, may be filled up in the morning, whether it's residents there or not, but it declines throughout the course of the day. But it's a little bit further outside of the downtown core. The private parking spaces are, again, as I said, something that are always an opportunity, but they're not something the city has direct control over. There's certainly hundreds of parking spaces that are available on a Thursday evening. It's the Saturday parking problem for the public spaces that are really the confrontation that the city has to think very carefully about, because the downtown overlay district, that that confined geography where the businesses are really trying to have customer spaces available is really hitting those capacity lines today. And here's a quick summary of the public lots on a Saturday. Again, the same level of variability, a lot of the similar patterns, not as much utilization of the Masonic lot or the South Mill lot, but heavy utilization on the other public lots. So one of the quick conclusions that we are able to make, and again, we're charged with reporting data, and we can only talk a little bit about the numbers that we've concluded, but we did also do a land use assessment that I'll get through. And as part of going through that process, we were able to recognize that today, there's actually a lot of vacancy in the properties in the downtown. You will find office space available. You'll find a few retail shops available. Not as much vacancy in the residential sector. But right now, your parking demand is technically at its low. So we counted at a typical point in the year, but it's technically in the span of several years a relatively low point, which makes sense. We're at a national lull in economic activity. What Portsmouth has as strengths are things that you're already capitalizing on and making things work more and more efficiently. And this is something that I think you by all means would continue to do naturally, and there may be some interventions to make this work even better. We call it internal capture, are incredible compared to most places in the country at getting people to more or less not drive their cars as much as they might elsewhere. Folks will come to a business and walk to do their errands, to meet their friends, to do everything else, and then drive away. We call that a park once kind of environment. Those extra trips that would have happened are internally captured to the site of downtown Portsmouth. And similarly, shared parking works very much the same way, because if you come and park once and don't drive around, well, you used your parking space as a shared commodity for other trips. Even if it was a privately held parking space just for my business or my condo association, it was effectively a shared parking resource. So part of our work tries to appreciate that. If we went out and did a count, and this was done several years ago in Portsmouth, of all of the trips going in and out of Portsmouth, the data shows that you are already less than half the national trip rate for what should be going on in that radius of all that activity. And your AM and your PM peak hour trips are at least a quarter or a third less than national averages. These are good signs of what Portsmouth is. Sharing is also something very key, as I was saying. Again, this is that same kind of hypothetical demand profile across the course of a day. And sharing basically looks at the natural synergies. It's not forcing us to have public parking. We're just saying if you're an office building, this is a hypothetical 150,000 square foot office building, the peak of the demand may be in the afternoon at 2 p.m. But what we'll frequently assume is that that office building needs to build its full supply and then a little bit more to safely accommodate the users there. And that would therefore expect that you have a constant supply dedicated for office use. Similarly for a restaurant, you can have a lot of restaurant busy in the middle of the day, busy again in the evenings. At that one particular point of the day, it was noontime, and we'll often say to a restaurant, build all the parking to accommodate that. Residential is a great use to have in a mixed-use downtown like yours because its peak demand usually happens overnight, off the hours of this chart. And that's oftentimes what we expect that we need to build to, and sometimes we do to be sure that everybody has a place to put their car at night. But when you combine all of these graphs, what you effectively have in this example is at least a third reduction as a result of sharing parking well. And that's something that's happening in Portsmouth today. What we did was instead of just doing our parking projections based on standard assumptions of the maximum amount of parking, we overlapped the demand curves throughout the course of the day. And this is a result in the study area of looking at your land uses and how they would normally behave. And as there's the residential curve, not as many residences in downtown, but you can see it gets a little bit thicker towards the end of the day. Here's the commercial shopping core, and here's the offices. And up top here, we have the absolute amount of parking supply, that 5,600 parking spaces, as I mentioned earlier. And the demand curve from the model says you should only be using about 3,500 or so of those. Well, we then stacked up the actual observed utilization chart that we had, and it very nearly matches the model. In fact, it's a tiny bit better than that. So these aspects of your downtown are working very, very well to your benefit. You also have already performance-based pricing, is what we call it in the industry. There is an incentive for folks to go park further out because it's going to be cheaper or free, and that's obviously what a lot of folks are doing today by parking in the Parrot lot as well as across the railroad tracks, whereas the downtown core, that's the place that some of the longer-term employees avoid. Quick findings we also noted is that parking demand is absolutely going to grow as your vacancies decline. You're doing so good in the shared parking world that you, to some degree, need to look at our findings as your baseline. Anything that involves more activity, development, better vacancy rates will naturally increase the amount of parking demand in your downtown. You also have some walkability barriers, which I think some folks are sort of aware of, that make it somewhat difficult to easily access more remote spaces such as the Masonic lot. These are not necessarily spaces that could be used by everybody but might be able to be long-term. In the downtown core, you don't have a problem with this. You have some of the best pedestrian facilities in the Northeast. But as you get to certain, this is the intersection just coming out of downtown, and this, you know, the pedestrian is not as evident. This is Islington and Maplewood, right? Is that right? So it's this intersection here. And there's a few of these intersections that tend to be those kinds of barriers. Folks are not going to want to walk across the causeway all the time, though some way, or across the bridge to get to remote parking. But they're things that would make access to remote spaces a little bit better. And then, of course, as I've said a few times, the sharing of private spaces is part of the overall downtown supply. Works naturally fairly okay, but it's not working incredibly well. And a lot of that is just very clearly shown simply through the lack of utilization of private spaces throughout the day in aggregate. That's a lot of parking on whether it's a Thursday, a weekday, or on a weekend day, hundreds of spaces that just are not used consistently throughout the course of the day. So there's a lot of private parking that could be utilized a little bit better to help alleviate issues in the core. So one thing I wanted to do was also talk about the pricing. That's what this slide says. So pricing in the core is possibly not high enough. You already have the distinction of pricing working to motivate people to go to remote spaces, but there's still a desire to get as close as you can to Market Square and hunt around before you eventually wind up in the garage or further away. And as you look at the utilization profile, this is sort of the peak of the weekday, for instance, you'll see, again, those remote spaces that are dirt cheap all day long, people are busy, and the core is busy. But as you look right outside of it, this surrounding area, there's a lot of on-street parking as well as off-street that could be better utilized. It's actually less utilized than some of the remote spaces. And what it's suggesting is that you have the opportunity to make the pricing in your core even higher and maybe discount some of this parking to get better utilization of those spaces. So the second half of our work was to project parking demand. And as I suggested to you earlier, we use a shared parking model that walks through how the actual behavior of shared parking would work. And here's some of the results of it. We first looked at the entire study area, and then we broke out those two sub areas, and I'll walk you through each of these curves. First of all, the land uses in that overall study area, the entire 5,600 parking spaces that we counted are broken out here, and essentially it's over a couple million square feet. There's a very strong commercial mix that's in there. There's some government buildings, there's obviously some apartment buildings, and a mix of a variety of uses. If we were to just look at the straight old flat demand of each of all those uses, and maybe discounted a little bit for the access to walking and other amenities you have in a downtown, but not really looking at how they might be shared, the demand in that area would, in theory, be a little over 5,000 parking spaces. And you have, as I said, 5,600 parking spaces, which works well. But again, right now, the peak of your demand is only about 3,400 today. Now, our shared parking model ran very closely to the actual observed utilization. So if we were to look again at the total ITE unshared demand, that would be the flat bar of what everybody would be using, a little over 5,000 parking spaces. But in reality, the curve, and please ignore this dashed line that's not supposed to be there. It was from an earlier presentation. The 1,500 parking space gap, in theory, is how much parking there is today available above the peak of your peak utilization when we are sharing all of our parking spaces before you hit the last 10% that is effectively full. We're calling it on this map, on this graphic, reserve capacity. So if you've got 1,500 parking spaces in theory, we mapped out the actual utilization. That seems pretty close. The model seems to work, except in reality, there are vacancies that we had to account for. We assumed, again, some 20% office, 5% retail, 2% in the residential market. These are our assumptions for reductions according to different kind of user groups in that shared parking model. These are pretty standard percentage reductions. Demand management has a lot to do with the fact that parking is priced and people are incentivized to use other modes of transportation. When you start to account for these kinds of factors in your downtown, it increases the amount of available parking a little bit, up to almost 1,800 parking spaces, and that's a dead ringer for the utilization curve. If we were to zoom in a little bit, the downtown overlay district, the core of the core, its overall demand is, in theory, according to IT, like about 3,200 parking spaces. When we run the shared parking curve, now you've only got about a 600 space gap to utilization. But again, gap to the peak of utilization. But it's above what we observed. When we throw in the vacancy rates, these affect the downtown a little bit more significantly. It's more like an 840 space gap. So 840 spaces today in the downtown, all public and private parking combined as a pool is all you've got left. But when you start to fill up those vacancies, it becomes a little bit less than that. And then we also looked at the 5-minute walking radius. And this is, we calculate this as essentially the actual walking routes that somebody could take from that star, from Market Square, for 5 minutes. And within that 5-minute walking boundary, remember, this is the on-street and off-street parking, it's starting to be a little bit more constrained, but there's some capacity that's available. ITE says it's about 2,500 parking spaces. The shared parking model initially says it's a little over 2,000. When we adjust for vacancy, it's about 270 parking spaces that are left more or less in that hypothetical bank today, without folks filling up vacancies or without development. We then threw in some future land uses. These are the only pipeline projects that are more or less in the bank, in theory, assuming they actually do follow through. Port Walk, as we know, is hopefully coming forward soon. Two phases, we assumed, as well as their changes in parking supply, 51 Islington, some residential and retail, 30 Maplewood, a couple phases of residential and retail with some parking there as well. When you throw this all into the mix and we look at the downtown overlay district, again, that slightly bigger commercial core, but not our entire study area. In that area, when we throw in the demand and we also add in, the vacancy rates as well. So now we're fully occupied. This is your future to look at. It's basically saying that if you continue to share things perfectly, in theory, there are about 600 spaces. When you look at the 5-minute core, this is really the max you could expect a visitor to be walking from Market Square, not necessarily everything you consider your downtown overlay district. That's when things get a little bit tighter with the shared parking model. So in there, we're at a point of only about 100 spaces or so before you're effectively at your capacity. Now that's today within the 5-minute radius again of that core. And so what that conclusion is saying is that you're getting very, very, very close to full when you actually fill up those vacancies and everything that's on the table today. You're going to be, you know, a couple, few dozen spaces from full effectively. Here's a summary of that. Again, today in the entire study area, there's this excess capacity of 1,800 parking spaces. That's great. But when you really look at the 5-minute walking core, the area that is the heart and soul of Portsmouth, it's only a few hundred parking spaces, and a good half of that supply is effectively never going to be available. It's in that last 10% that we consider over capacity. And the same, when we look into the future, this is really the core message here that we throw out as a concern, and I'm not really necessarily making direct conclusions on how to deal with this reality, but effectively, you've only got about 100 parking spaces left in the future pipeline in that core of downtown before you have a problem. You're sort of knocking at the capacity threshold. And I don't say that in a lot of places where I do work, and I work all around the country, because oftentimes there's places that could do a lot more in terms of sharing their parking and improving their downtown's walkability and doing pricing, and you do a lot of that. Tiny things here and there could be improved, but overall, you're one of the better practices in the country. And so what it's saying is that there's something that you need to be thinking about in your very near-term future. Staff had asked me to break at this point, take any inputs on our parking study and findings. I have some other best practices we can just talk about as food for thought later, but I wanted to hear in particular from the council if there are any questions about that information. Or I'll take questions from anybody at this point.
Thank you. One of the questions I had is some of the data that you have.
Thank you. On some of the data that you have, for instance, the Masonic lot. We don't have that available to us after, I believe it's 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock in the evening. Mm-hmm. When you were putting your numbers together, did you subtract out those as available parking?
We're just looking at the total amount of parking in the entire area at all times. So there's a lot of specific locations like that that may have different operational additions. We weren't able to necessarily adjust for that in the total amount. In terms of when you have a crunch factor, for instance, that total number at that particular time is at a different point of the day. Your biggest crunch on street, the feeling perception is in the evenings, but the actual overall supply crunch is happening midday on a weekday.
Okay, thank you for answering that, because I also saw the post office lot isn't available to the public at all. Mm-hmm. It's only available for the employees of that.
Right, and there's a lot of parking that's shown on those maps that is exactly that. It's entirely in the private hands.
You touched a little bit on the summer months, but your presentation was really in the off months. So whatever you said in October is going to be exacerbated in the summer months. Then and that was obvious from the presentation. But the question that I have is that Portsmouth also spends a lot of time on special events and draws in the community that are not really part of the average. Did you give any consideration as to the impact on our parking for such things as the races or Market Square Day or some of the other summer events that we have to try to come up with a peak demand?
We did not, and it wasn't necessarily part of our scope to do that. I would certainly say, looking at the information, clearly there's going to be more pressure during the summers. In theory, a lot of this data will enable folks to be able to look more specifically at those events, but I can't really say because we weren't here to count special events. Oh, Planning Board and Economic Development Commission is here as well. Great.
I think one of the things that maybe throws us off a little is the amount of parking under private hands, because we're typically thinking of public since that's what we can control. And particularly on the last bar graph that you showed, mm-hmm. when we think of that capacity, that was both public and private, right?
Correct.
So, you know, I mean, I don't know if it's fair to say, is it pretty much 50-50 in terms of how you think of that, or are we thinking that, you know, we have only about 50 spaces excess capacity in the 5-minute
walk?
Yeah,
this is, you make a very good point. This is public and private parking in the downtown.
Right.
So, and I could easily pull out the numbers and get them for you on which shares which. I think to some degree it's sort of moot. That's a tight number.
It's very tight, yeah. And I guess a question about the public-private. Is our balance pretty typical for what you see? Is a lot in private hands? And because, you know, that, so much of this in my mental picture of it would change if I was only thinking of the public availability and what we control.
Yeah, it's very few places that have more public parking than private parking, even when you shrink in on a pretty tight geography. And I should note that we have been including in these analyses as part of the public supply the Portwalk lot, which is technically privately owned right now, but it's part of the public pay parking supply. But if you took that off of the table, which I'll mention in the next half, then you certainly have more constraint on the public supply.
Okay.
Because I don't really know how to frame the question, but I think what everybody is trying to get at is how do we have a parking system that most benefits the businesses downtown? And I think because what comes from that is the pedestrians, the users' experiences, the better the businesses do. Did you look at all about, I know you capture utilization of a space, but there's not really much talk about turnover of that space. Is it general parking practice that the more turnover, the better? Or, I mean, I understand lots have different purposes. Some are commuter lots, and you want an eight-hour space. But can you talk a little bit about turnover in spaces?
We didn't do a turnover analysis, and sometimes when we do studies where we have that scoped, we will do it. It tends to be a descriptive factor that to some degree helps with the perception of where there might be availability, but it actually does not equal availability. You could have 10 parking spaces and 7 of those spaces could be filled all day with the same 7 people, but that lot is 30% available. You'll always find a parking space in that lot. So availability and turnover don't necessarily correlate. In, for instance, places like I'll talk about that have started to implement a lot of the more progressive parking management policies that are even stretching beyond what Portsmouth is doing today, they find that their turnover reduces. Length of stay actually may increase because that's what the customers had wanted. But the availability, the ability to find a parking space, has increased. That's the key thing. And so one of the most important aspects to remember in a downtown and in terms of access is maintaining availability. Turnover oftentimes relates to it, but it's not a very good direct measure of availability.
I guess, and then tying into when you offer free parking, either on a weekend or a holiday, or how does that affect everything? Are people's behaviors are obviously changing with that? Maybe you can comment on that.
There is no question that the number one motivator of parking decisions, in fact, travel decisions by most people, has to do with pricing. If the parking space is free, then you're going to go rush to it, and sometimes that'll affect people driving instead of walking. But if there's only so many parking spaces and they're all free, first come, first serve, they'll all be filled up. And so in areas where you find it impossible to find parking, we will often recommend the price is too low and should be higher. When you go free, all bets are off.
Another quick question. There's sometimes discussion, obviously this begs the question of, are we going to build more parking? But along with that is, just how far out can parking be built before it becomes ineffective to solve a parking problem. Is it within walking, past walking distance? Does there need to be a bus? At some point, the distance is so great that we aren't receiving a benefit from it at all. Do you have any experience that you could share with us along those lines?
It generally, in my experience, and I can't apply this directly to Portsmouth again, it's not exactly something we studied, but in my experience, indeed, people really want to try to be at the front door as much as possible of whatever their destination is. So if the parking garage could always be right out front, more or less, that's where people would want it. But it has a lot to do with what the environment is, and you have a good environment that makes people very comfortable walking not only to the Parrot lot, but many folks regularly park across the causeway and don't worry about it because it's not that long a walk. They might enjoy it. And for instance, if you go into downtown Boston, a lot of people like to park underneath the Boston Common Garage because it's cheaper, and then you get to walk through Boston Common to get to your destination. Even if it's a 10-20 minute walk, you don't care. It has everything to do with the relative value of where you want to go. The more and more your downtown is enjoyable and walkable, the further you can push that distance where you would put parking. But, you know, remember, customers first. And for most downtowns, there's employees, there's residents, there's commuters, but the customer is usually what's keeping the engine alive. And customers, not only do they want to park proximate to the shops, they want to park out front. It's hard to put a parking garage right out front.
How far is too
far? I know a few places that have operated remote parking with a shuttle type system successfully, other than major systems, major cities, and it's taken the T in from Alewife for the remote park and ride. In downtowns, to run a remote park and ride system, it's usually a crutch for a broken management system in the downtown. If you actually price things a little bit better and motivated attitudes and what have you, folks would go out there of their own volition. Rockport, Mass. Has a remote shuttle that they run during the busy season, and it's where the tourists go because they can't find parking in the downtown because everybody in the know found all the parking spaces, and your number one economic development engine is forced to go ride the shuttle bus in from the landfill parking lot. So they're not the best strategies.
So at what point does the impression from people who are coming to town basically stop them from coming to town? So for instance, you know, with Saturday nights at 8 o'clock in October, where you're out of capacity in all the, you know, 5 minute walking zone, is that enough, just that happening in and of itself, to deter a significant number of people from coming downtown to do their business?
There is not a lot of real science that relates that question very well, and I wish there was, because if you have a parking problem, it's oftentimes a good thing, at least under our current forms of parking management. If your streets are packed and nobody can find a parking space, that means there's activity and people want to be there. So that's not necessarily a bad thing. To then say, well, you could have more people if you built a lot of parking garages, is possibly missing the boat on what's really attracting people. Sometimes it's the scarcity that draws people, and there are places that I know have had very sophisticated parking authorities. Silver Spring, Maryland is one I'm thinking of, that had a system that allowed them to build as much public parking as they wanted to, and they built tons of it. And the core of Silver Spring is barely, after 30 years, becoming even remotely livable on one block. I mean, they had the opportunity of the growing D.C. metro region to really capitalize economic development and didn't do a good job at it. So it's not just building parking. They missed out on nice walkable streets and nice convenient front door parking and the mix of active uses that you have in Portsmouth that really engender that kind of demand. So it's not always creating the parking supply that's going to draw people. But if there's no parking to be found, yes, absolutely, people will leave. I live in Somerville, Massachusetts, Davis Square, and I've worked in the Metro Boston area, and I go to other communities to do parking studies, and I say, oh, I live down there, and they say, oh man, Somerville, I used to go to that theater, I went down, I couldn't find parking, I got a parking ticket, I haven't gone back. And that mayor, it's the last thing he wants to hear. So indeed, there is a relationship. It's not the only thing, but it's certainly part of it.
If I could follow up on an earlier question, your study looks at generalities of Thursdays, Saturdays, but let's look at the issue of when people come downtown for a big event like Market Square Day, when there's thousands of people here. Somehow they all manage to find parking. So what happens when we look at those kind of events? Is that helpful to say, how do we make this work?
I think that event parking is somewhat of a unique creature. It is a time when everybody is willing to deal with what they have. Frequent times events are on Sundays when parking is free or parking is incentivized for free to draw folks for economic development. And everybody and anybody is ready and willing to spend an hour just getting to a parking space and walking around downtown. It's hard to use that parking activity as a example of how you would do it the rest of the time when we're trying to go about our daily lives. There's some parts and aspects of it that are pretty good, but sometimes, as I mentioned in Rockport, Mass., they're used poorly. That remote shuttle works fine when there's a big festival, but on an average day, it's the place of least desire.
Given what you just said, I'm a firm believer that if Saturday nights are our problem, and the couple times during the summer are our problems, then maybe we need to look at a shuttle and some place to go and provide it. And I think it's looking at two different times a year. If you look at the summer problem and the winter problem on a Saturday night. I mean, it sounds like we're getting down to Saturday night, to be honest with you. That might be the issue here in some respects, at least from Labor Day to Memorial Day. Have you seen any place? I've always been under the idea that we should run a shuttle from Pierce Island over for Saturday nights. Have you seen any place where people kind of, or the community kind of looks at that as a one-time event on a Saturday night? We know Saturday night there's a shuttle where people will come and say, we want to be part of the activity, that we'll be willing to do that. Have you seen any place just do it like a one night, knowing that Saturday night is our problem?
I have a great example for you. It's Nantucket and Nantucket, Massachusetts, where during the summers, every night is sort of a Saturday night, but even in the hip seasons. And they set up a transit authority, specifically back in the 80s, I think, to begin to try to deal with what was beginning to be a huge problem then. And their downtown was extremely constrained and still is constrained, very heavily utilization, the heaviest I've ever seen percentage-wise in the entire country. The problem is that even with that shuttle system running at all sorts of hours to free park and ride lots with all sorts of incentives, half of which are to ride it for free, it is still kind of the marginal user who uses it. It is the person who is of their own volition ready and willing to go ride a bus and wait in the traffic to get into downtown, as opposed to the majority of people who wait in their cars for 45 minutes to drive a half mile to spend another 30 minutes circling in downtown for a parking space that may eventually open up, miss their reservation, and just go to the next restaurant. That is ultimately where people want to be, is in the core. Everybody wants to get to the front door as much as possible. Nantucket has very few disincentives to come to the front door. If you were to have a remote shuttle somewhere, it would have to be balanced by a strong incentive to make everybody want to do that. And still, you would have to deal with the fact that you're probably catering to people who are willing and ready to ride a shuttle. And there's very few environments where that is more desirable than driving or walking or biking. It may work. There's remote Alps towns, the only way to get in is on a shuttle, and then it's all walkable. Mackinac Island in Michigan works exactly that way, but with a ferry. It's just hard to push people there if there's no incentive. Your downtown will be packed with people looking for parking, and they will do that before they will go out to the remote location and ride the bus all the time, unless your downtown is really expensive to park in.
Thank you.
I don't know if you're willing to make a projection for us, but with the anticipated growth with 30 Maplewood Ave, the third phase of Port Walk, hopefully a conference center, are you willing to stick your neck out and say you do need an additional parking garage, or you know, you do need some kind of substantial additional parking to handle all this anticipated expanded growth?
I think the conclusions are fairly obvious here in that regard. I haven't really sat down to say, okay, these are the things that Portsmouth could be doing. I know off the top of my head a lot of strategies that are out there. I know this number on the screen certainly suggests that you're going to have a supply problem. I've said it here today. You know, do you guys want to rip down a bunch of buildings and pave parking lots? That's another way of doing it. I wouldn't do that necessarily. Do you want to build garages? That's one way of dealing with it. Do you want to have incredibly aggressive measures that are approaching top of the nation that, you know, have congestion pricing and charges so nobody can drive into the downtown and so you never have to build a parking garage? You could do that too. It just doesn't seem like the most easy path to get somewhere. So I would suggest one of your easiest paths indeed has to do with new supply.
You might want to save this for the best practice, but have you seen any communities where they have successfully altered the culture so that in fact many people do believe that the customer is first? Because I think that's one of the challenges, and you mentioned Rockport, that if you've got employees taking up those spaces, or if you have residents really not believing that, then you have, I think, what we have, which is sort of this stalemate around different perspectives of, you know, who should have the front door step.
Right.
It would be interesting to have people say, but my observation certainly would not be from most of our parking discussions, do people think the customer comes first? So have you seen anybody that doesn't have that culture successfully build that culture?
There is not a community in the U.S. who hasn't had this exact issue. And it basically comes down to even the most well-intentioned business owners and merchants saying, no, I've got employee parking far away, I buy them the remote permits, they know not to park out front. If you've got part-time employees and you've got tons of them in Portsmouth, they're gonna just park where it's cheapest, easiest, and frequently that's two doors down. And that does happen in lots of places. Meter feeding and moving the car around, even if it's more expensive than parking remotely, it may just be quarters, and the time value, especially a part-time worker who's got to get home to kids or the next job, it's gonna take too long to walk 5 or 6 minutes when the shift is over. And that makes sense for the tip quarters, even if it costs them more to get that space two doors down. What we found is that it really has a lot to do with pricing those spaces accordingly. It's hard to get any downtown into. It's a customer problem, it's a employee problem, it's the residents. User groups all react a little bit differently to different motivations and have different preferences, but one thing that's common to all of them is the buck. And when it hits your wallet, it makes you think twice. And so the best practices in the U.S. have been a lot of small communities. I'm about to talk to you, I hope, about a place called Redwood City, where they price their parking in a performance-based way, and the merchants were rallying around it. One of the best examples in America, Pasadena, California, they're the ones who passed it because it enabled the customer access you were talking about. And the largest parking demonstration project in the country right now, SF Park, is, you can read the news, is doing amazing things, letting people know where their parking space is on their mobile devices, but creating availability and fairness and revenues for downtown business associations. So it has a lot to do with how that asset is managed and less to do with saying it's an employee problem, when oftentimes it is, because it's oftentimes a resident problem. It's everybody's problem.
Have you had any information regarding when you're talking about pricing? As we look to the future and the price of gasoline is going up, is there any correlation between the price of gasoline going up and folks being more willing to do remote parking and public transportation?
Absolutely. During the last spike in fuel prices, and we're starting to work our way back up there, there's a huge shift to public transportation nationally. What's great about it is that in most places it's maintained. Those people shifted and liked it and stayed. Maybe the economy had some sort of motivation there, but a lot of folks, it has a lot to do with just trying the bus out and realizing it ain't so bad. Unfortunately, I deal with lots of transit places, and the planners haven't even ridden their bus. But once they do, they start to have an enlightenment too. So indeed, there is a way to shift people's travel behavior through pricing, not just creating availability on street out front so customers can get into your business, but actually making people think twice about making that trip at all. Sometimes they know they can park remotely more cheaply or a few blocks away more cheaply, but they're thinking, well, I really want to save a buck. I don't want to walk 10 minutes away when I could leave my house and bike in 15 minutes, and they will make that conscious decision. So pricing can have that dual effect, and certainly gas prices and taxes and all of those factors come into play. Gas prices are more effective than others because people see it regularly. Parking prices, you see it when you go and pay. Taxes on your car, you only see once a year and don't think about. So it's part of revealing the cost.
Is it the ideal situation that you're trying to achieve for municipalities to have a surfeit of parking as close to the center of your activity as possible? Alternatives like shuttle buses and bicycles and so forth, they work sometimes, but they don't work well. Human nature isn't likely to use them as much. We have this thing called winter, you know, bicycles and so forth don't work well then. And it's one thing if there's if you can't create parking spaces, but in this situation, we have a situation where we can create a parking garage, the Worth parking lot. Mm-hmm. This study is a study upon a study that has been studied. I don't know how long you've lived in this town, but I've been here 60 plus years, and that's all we've ever talked about is our shortage of parking. And I have the feeling that sometimes that this study of the parking is sort of an anti-Worth parking lot faction, you know, trying to prevent that building when you have a perfectly good location to put a parking garage that would be unobtrusive and so forth. Anyways, but isn't the ideal to have is excess parking as close to the activity as you want? And once you built the Worth parking lot, then the old post office or the post office lot becomes available for another parking garage, and we could be in a situation where we had more parking than we know what to do with, which would be a dream.
I think that the answer I would give you is balance. And I think this is something that we all have a hard time understanding when it comes to parking and transportation. We know that we want to have a balance of economy and a balance of uses and a good mix of means of access. But when it comes to parking, it's very much in our minds the third rail of access to a community. And without doubt, it needs to be there. It has everything to do with how you manage it and how much there is of it. If you had a lot of parking that was available, the effective price for that parking is so low from the user perspective that I would have no interest in getting here by any other means. So communities that overbuild their parking are places that have no walking, biking, or even transit use. And I can point to dozens of Midwestern cities that built their downtowns on that philosophy, and the before and after pictures of streetcar downtowns and now completely gutted downtowns with parking garages is pretty devastating. Those communities are also leading a change in America that has a lot to do with balance and recognizing that they can have more development, share their parking, get to a better ratio between parking and floor area, between motor vehicle access and walking and biking access, and you already are in a position with a strong balance. I think these numbers suggesting that you're starting to lose the balance a little bit in terms of parking. There are, as I will have suggested, some additional management approaches. You might be able to have steeper parking pricing tiers. You might be able to improve some intersections. You might be able to manage things a little bit differently. But ultimately, yeah, you're starting to get at a supply point. But I would never advocate thinking that you should just try to build as much parking as you possibly can, because that will completely shift the economic value of your downtown, which is something that Davenport, Iowa has been dreaming of, which is why they've decided to say eliminate the parking requirements. We, you know, get rid of the one-way couplets. We want a walkable downtown. We look to the Portsmouth of America and realize we've done it wrong. You're getting a crunch. The Worth location seems like a great location. I get it. I can't tell you anything specifically about locations in your downtown, about where you could or should put parking, but just think about balance and recognize that you want to be smart about it for the future. Should I run through these remaining best practice slides that make some sense for folks? And I will only do like 15 minutes on it. It's a little bit of a food for thought process that may spark some thoughts and ideas. And if it sparks you to go home better thought processed, that's good by me. So best practices in downtown parking, I've touched on a lot of these. So if you have to run, please go. But I only want to do this for about 10 minutes or so the night doesn't run too long. Building another parking garage. Part of the considerations about it that we all need to remember, we've sort of touched on a little bit, is cost, is pricing, is how does it integrate into the downtown? Can it be an amenity for the downtown? When you lose the Portwalk lot that's now public parking, you know, you're going to have more of a supply crunch. How do you deal with it? Basic market realities. The cost of parking, is going up. I mean, this is only 2002 breaking 30,000 per parking garage on average. It's continuing to climb. And when you look at each and every parking space that isn't used, you have to start thinking about, if it was $20,000 per parking space, what is the ultimate value of that? When we work with many of our clients, we talk about what is the user cost of all this parking infrastructure. So if it costs approximately in the industry $20,000 per parking space, which is actually low, like I say, you're probably over $30,000, but if you simply did a reverse mortgage on these basic numbers, I'm using a 7% interest, which is high these days, but I'm also extending it over a 40-year lifespan, which for a municipal bond is really short. This reflects the lifespan of a garage and how you'd amortize it. So this is actually a pretty low monthly amortization cost per parking space. So it starts to get to the reality of what you and I deal with when we park in a downtown. If you have to throw in the operating costs and maintenance and lighting, etc., $150 per space per month is just the money that's needed to finance the debt service. So when you talk about subsidizing things, if we're collecting, as the city does, for instance, right now, and this is typical of cities, $80 a month to park in High Hanover, there is a cost to subsidize that form of access. And so this is part of a values discussion about, you know, what are we subsidizing in our community? And, you know, we're basically saying we're, you know, a perk, more or less, to park. Now, you can take a lot of the cost off the table with federal subsidies, with different grant programs. You can play that money a little bit, but the bottom line of the investment is there. And we often like to point out, you know, when you have a productive restaurant space that creates a lot of money, creates a lot of economic opportunity, or an office cube, these are the kinds of downtown activities you want to bring people there. Far be it that we have nice, good downtown housing, and all of those are productive land uses that collect rent that we want to see. When parking takes up so much space, sometimes we're subsidizing affordable parking, affordable housing for cars. And so we just need to be very careful, which is why I talk to pricing being an important factor, because all those other land uses get priced very well. At the very least, when you do bring in a garage, and I'm saying you need to be thinking about supply, if you were to bring in a garage, we always say best practice is to do your best wrapping it, hiding it. These are parking garages. This is an active restaurant with a parking garage above. It's a beautiful building down in Arlington, Virginia. Now, it's not cheap. You know, it's $35,000 a parking space, but it's getting a lot of rental income as a result of this that offsets it. So it's part of that financial equation. This one's a little bit less expensive. It's not as pretty, but it's got some retail. This is just a standalone parking garage down in Lowell, Mass. It's 1,000 spaces, and it's still $2,400 a space. This is built two or three years ago now. And it's, you know, it's fine. They do markets next to it in the alley, but you got to understand some of the cost you're walking into with a garage. So that's part of what we want to always emphasize, is being smart about the balance you make. We also look at those accessibility connections, those walking barriers, as something that's very important. We're doing a parking garage study in Medford, Massachusetts, where they're going to build a parking garage to replace one that fell. And as we were doing the parking count, we realized that core intersection has this horrible performance for pedestrians. It's a square, or it used to be a square, and instead everybody gets off I-93 and plows through their downtown. There's modern pastries of the North End is there, and you wouldn't know it. There's great restaurants over here, but you can't even cross the main intersection because it's got levels of service for walking that are worse than most downtown vehicular intersections. And so what we realized was that intersection is actually creating a bit of a barrier, so that in the study area, within a walking distance of where they were putting their garage, there was effectively no available parking. The utilization on that side within that 5-minute walk of that garage site was maxed out. But if you went to the square and you changed it and made it public plazas in some parts, reduced the crossing distances, made it actually a public amenity in the process, but actually much less of a pedestrian barrier and cut down on the delays, this was the old 5-minute walking barrier distance that folks could do, and we extended it by improving this intersection right here dramatically with this dashed line, almost to the ideal, which is shaded. And what happened is it picked up all sorts of parking on the other side of the square. So effectively, we had bought them through intersection improvements 90 space parking lot, which changed their ability to program that garage, and they're doing some parking management to actually help offset the cost of the garage and doing it in phases. And so some of those thoughts, you know, as we look at the Masonic lot, for instance, it is a great resource at certain times of the day, but it is a long walk to get into downtown, and there's some places where crossing the streets may be slower or a bit of an imposition for an employee. So that's part of the balance of trying to understand how people walk around. We've also found places where, again, you have a lot of private parking spaces. Are there opportunities to work with the private spaces and manage it? It's a stretch. It's a difficult thing, but there are major cities in the U.S. who work as a public leasing authority of private parking spaces. I mean, when you look at your downtown, even at this busiest time, this is the evening parking, there's a lot of private parking that is available. In Needham, we recommended some of this best practice. Basically, they had a core lot. We did a study and looked at all the parking spaces in their downtown. And that lot right here in the core was under the control of Walgreens. And the town wanted to get it available to them. But part of the solution was looking at all the other lots nearby. And we realized that by combining them, breaking down fences, making different connections, they're able to actually get more parking supply. And the moral of the story is they could simplify the regulations, even potentially allow businesses to build on the alleys because they now have shared access instead of private driveways, and still get an increase in parking supply. But the town now is managing it for their own revenues, but also to be able to have people provided with places to park. They already sold employee parking permits. They could sell them in this lot for the same price or even less, because they actually had more to be able to sell by managing it. And it becomes a more attractive place for public parking when you do that. Indianapolis, Miami are two major cities who've been doing this for decades, managing their downtowns, and municipalities all around the country lease parking from private spaces. It's a management approach. It's a way to go about things. It can be difficult depending on who your landowners are and whether or not you got a bunch of contiguous spaces or whether or not they're even very large. In our inventory of Portsmouth, a lot of your parking is small lots, and it's hard to do. And then finally, incentivizing remote parking with steeper pricing tiers is one of these best practices I was talking about. Redwood City is sort of the poster child for this, and they had the issue of their main street being 100% full up. And everybody said, how are we ever going to have more businesses come into Redwood City? We're outside of San Francisco. Where's the economic opportunities happening for us? And the city realized right around the corner, the peak occupancy in some of their city-owned lots was less than 3/4. Even when it was a wild, crazy dot-com boom, they were still below those 85 and 90% targets. So they realized that it wasn't actually a parking shortage. They had a management problem on a much smaller microcosm than you guys do. But they decided that they had to institute pricing for the first time. They used it under a market rate system that essentially said the core is the most expensive, 50 cents an hour. The outside of it was 25 cents an hour. And then it was free outside of that. And that let people test the waters in terms of where they should be able to park. It was done strictly to be able to create availability. And they priced, you know, you can see the hours of operation, 11 a.m. to 8 p.m. There was no reason to price in the mornings. There wasn't enough demand. But on the weekends, they were pricing all the way till midnight because that's when they were getting activity in their downtown. But key was eliminating time limits. The time limits were a crutch for this turnover thing, and they realized availability was what they wanted. When they eliminated time limits, people actually stayed longer, but they got the availability in the front door parking spaces. And sort of the parking manager there is always entertaining when he quotes basically saying, why would you ever chase somebody away from a parking space by saying, oh, you've hit your time limit, we don't want you in our downtown anymore. So they eliminated them entirely because essentially that's a we're not welcome here anymore sign. Of course, it's also sign clutter. When you can eliminate a lot of the time limits and just have one, two, maybe three pricing tiers, it makes it very easy to understand your parking system, which is part of the customer conveniences. They brought in these pay-by-space meters. Lots of places do pay and display. There's smart meters, a variety of technologies. People can pay with credit cards. You've got them here in Portsmouth. They integrated them in every place they could possibly put them in Redwood City. And they even changed their employee and long-term parking programs the same way. For instance, here, the monthly permits at the High in Hanover would be more expensive and cheaper the further away you got from the core. What's great, again, is the average stay, like I say, actually went up. Folks had to leave at 60 minutes before, and folks stayed longer. So turnover wasn't necessarily, or the length of stay wasn't necessarily the factor. It was that they got to that occupancy target. Now, what was great was that they also had additional revenues that they dedicated into public services to improve their downtown, which was a big upside for the private sector to buy into the pricing program. And then customer conveniences, I'll just quickly touch on technologies. You guys have in-car meters in Portsmouth. It's a great national best practice. They've had mixed reception in a variety of places. Here's a place where it works well. There's a lot of technologies that are out there, and the vendor market is sort of sorting it all out. But it basically says you don't need a parking meter to park in some areas, which is nice. Or for frequent folks, you could use them. A lot of communities in the Northeast are experimenting with the smart meters. These are from a company called IPS. They're the only one out there. There's another company trying to make a similar version right now, and I'm sure they will, because these things work wonderfully. You can pay with a credit card right at your parking space. There it is in Harvard Square. Here it is in Davis Square. It's something that you will see soon. A lot of places have started to integrate cell phone payment. They work very well with those types of smart meters, and the real customer convenience kick is parking and completely walking away from your car, not talking to a pay station or a smart meter at all, just hitting the speed dial on your cell phone and having it calling you when your time is running out to ask you if you want to refresh your time. Down in Montgomery County, Maryland, they just brought this in about a year ago. This is in Silver Spring, and the sign-up rate was crazy. It's been a very successful pilot. We're also suggesting that you have the right kind of downtown and your access patterns work very well to have some form of advanced information to help mitigate where folks go and where some of the traffic is, to let folks know that there might be some remote parking that's available, that the garage may be approaching capacity and you should try a lot instead. And these technologies are becoming more and more common. You'll find them certainly at airports, but in a lot of malls now and some downtowns, certainly all over Europe. And getting it onto the handhelds is where technology is at, and the cost of this has really come down. And these are some examples from SF Park, where they actually have now started to use curbside sensors that provide that information to folks in advance, and you know what parking is available, what parking is costing too much, where you might want to go to start your trip, and whether you want to drive or not. That was just a few quick best practices I wanted to mention. I think we talked a little bit about many of those ideas earlier. If there's any other questions, I'm happy to take some questions from the crowd. It is approaching 8:30. I don't know if the city manager wants to make any final comments beforehand.
Well, thank you, Jason. As I said in my introduction, in terms of next steps, I envision the city staff will take the key data from the Nelson Nygaard work and develop a series of options for consideration by the City Council, the Planning Board, and the Economic Development Commission. Ultimately, the decisions made on the basis of the detailed parking data that has been developed will help shape the policy decisions, which may involve funding, may involve regulatory changes, or may be a combination of both. We will post the Nelson Nygaard final report as well as tonight's PowerPoint on the website. And for those who are interested, tonight's presentation will also be rebroadcast on Channel 22 at 7 p.m. this Saturday, January 28th. We also will be providing those that couldn't make it tonight with a DVD, as well as having it up on the website. We now have a more user-friendly way of viewing some of these on the website, so you'll actually be able to follow along and take another look at it if you want, and we'll have that posted tomorrow. So I want to take this opportunity to thank all of you that came out tonight, and I guess we have one question in the back. That's what we're going to do, Counselor. Correct, and we're going to post the second one tomorrow.
Okay, and the other thing, can we post, I know last time you were here, you did talk about the word block and what the ramifications were and what was some of the difficulties with that. Can we post that too, your comments?
I don't have any analysis or anything related to that. What I know about the worth lot is about what you know about the worth lot. The worth lot, from my perspective, as I said before, makes a lot of sense for a parking structure, and you have to evaluate the costs of it very closely.
Well, again, thank you for coming this evening, and we'll stay afterwards to answer any questions other people might have. Is one more in the back. I saw your hand. If you would like to make a comment.
Well, let me just take a moment to clarify. The worth lot is not cost-effective compared to building on a completely open site. I mean, that's sort of obvious. There are some certain constraints you have to adjust for on that lot. I haven't looked at it in sufficient detail to make it an engineered analysis, but looking at it, you've got limited access points. You're building against other buildings, so there's going to have to be certain accommodations in the structure of that. In urban environments, you should expect that the construction price for a garage will be a little bit higher than building it in a cornfield, and that's effectively what you have to confront on the worth lot site.
And thank you, Jason. Again, what we're going to do, what Nelson Nygaard did was pull together data for us as city staff and as policymakers to go forward to evaluate some of the options. It's not necessarily, I think what the city staff has to do is to give options to the City Council along working with the Economic Development Commission and the Planning Board. And as I said, it could be a combination of regulatory and infrastructure improvements, or a combination of what Jason talked about with best management. A lot of things we're doing today are in the leading of part of the field of parking, but also we can do better. That is going to be what we'll be discussing with all the stakeholders that we had here tonight, and including our policymakers, the city council. So that's where we'll head. We have some real good data. I think this this study was worthwhile, and I think we're going to be able to shape some of this information to whatever comes out of this. I think we're going to have a better process for making decisions as it relates to parking downtown and in the city. So, again, thank you for coming this evening. Thank you for your comments.